Hello, welcome to Data in the Classroom with NOAA. My name is Becca Lampe, and I'm an Outreach and Education Coordinator with the NOAA Office of Education. Today, I'm going to be explaining the different types of data resources that NOAA has available that might be particularly useful for educators. Before I get started, I'll mention that this presentation will have lots of links in it. You can find all of these links at noaa.gov/data-ed-presentation-2020. So no need to scribble anything down or take screenshots. In this presentation, I will answer these questions. What is NOAA? What types of data does NOAA have? How do we collect our data? How can you use NOAA data in your classroom? Where can you find NOAA data sets to use in your classroom? And how can students be involved in data collection? First of all, what is NOAA? NOAA stands for the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. We are a federal science agency, so we are part of the United States government. This is our vision and our mission, but I'm not going to read those to you. I like to talk more about our tagline, which is Science, Service, Stewardship. When people think about NOAA, they often first think of our science work. NOAA studies and predicts changes in climate, weather, the ocean, and coasts. Then we share that information with others as a service. Finally, we focus on stewardship and use our knowledge to protect people and the environment. Education is especially important in stewardship. We take this data and use it to figure out what we can do to make our world a better place. NOAA is really, really big. There are 6 line offices within NOAA, and some of those line offices have programs within them that you may have also heard of. There's our Office of Oceanic and Atmospheric Research, which includes our Climate Program Office, our Ocean Exploration Office, and our Ocean Acidification Program. NOAA Fisheries is also known as the National Marine Fisheries Service, and they are the only policymaking wing of NOAA in addition to their data monitoring of fishery populations. The National Environmental Satellite Data and Information Service monitors our planet using satellites. The National Weather Service is the most well-known branch of NOAA. I recommend getting your daily weather forecast at weather.gov. The National Ocean Service has many programs within it, like our National Marine Sanctuaries, the Marine Debris Program, and our Charting Office. Finally, the Office of Marine and Aviation Operations manages the NOAA fleet of ships and planes. All of these offices are important contributors to NOAA data. So now let's talk about that data. NOAA has petabytes of data. 1 petabyte is 1,000 gigabytes, in case that's a new word for you. What this means is that NOAA has tons and tons of data available in many different formats, including the ones I've listed here. Nearly all data that NOAA collects is freely available for anyone who wants it. This data comes from different places. NOAA collects data from land, from the ocean, from the atmosphere, and even from space. Ground-based observations from NOAA can collect weather, climate, and coastal information. There are weather stations, research labs, and other locations where NOAA collects data all across the country. NOAA also collects data from the ocean. NOAA has 17 research vessels in our fleet. These vessels collect hydrographic, oceanographic, and fishery data. We also have buoys that collect data, including tsunami monitoring buoys and ones that can collect data from the deep sea or the sea surface. Some buoys even collect data from the air. NOAA also collects data from the air, often using airplanes. Our hurricane hunters fly into storms to collect important data used in hurricane forecasting. There are also aerial surveys that can collect marine mammal data and weather data, like the aftermath of snowstorms, tornadoes, and flooding. NOAA has environmental satellites that monitor the Earth. The data that is collected by these satellites can be used in weather forecasting, monitoring ocean health, and even sea level rise. NOAA has 2 main types of satellites: the geostationary operational environmental satellites, or GOES, are geostationary with the Earth's rotation. This means that it is orbiting the Earth at the same speed that the Earth is rotating, so it's always looking at the same part of the Earth. We also have polar orbiting satellites that circle the Earth around the poles and collect data from the entire planet. So how can you use NOAA data? There are a few ways you can incorporate NOAA data into things that you're probably already doing in your classes or may be interested in starting. You might be thinking, does this fit into my curriculum? The answer is most likely. Data is important in many different fields. Here are just a few examples of subjects and themes you might be working with that you can incorporate NOAA data into. Next, we're going to take some time to look into some of our specific resources. As I said earlier, NOAA has tons and tons of data. Some of these resources can be a bit difficult to find, so I'm helping you to find them here. Remember, you can visit noaa.gov/data-ed-presentation-2020 to find all of these links. NOAA Education actually has a website where you can find most of these resources all in one place. You can find that by going to noaa.gov/education, then clicking on Resource Collections. All the way at the bottom of the Resource Collections, we have a section called Data Resources for Educators. Many of the resources I'm going to talk about today can be found in that collection, but there are even more for you to dig into. The data collections look like this. They are organized by the headers Classroom Ready, Easily Accessible Resources, and Looking for More. Classroom Ready resources are lessons using NOAA data that are ready to go. You don't have to do anything extra to get started. Easily accessible resources are just what they sound like. They are data sources themselves. They don't require too many clicks to get to or too much work on your part to understand what you're looking at. Then we have a section called Looking for More. Some of NOAA's data is a bit complicated to understand or requires a lot of clicks to find the data, or it may be very raw and technical. And these are ones that we think are really interesting and useful, but may require a little more effort on your part to bring this into your class. Next, I'm going to show you a few examples of some of my favorite data resources that we have. First up, Data in the Classroom. I borrowed the title of this website to use for this whole presentation because it's really one of my favorites. This website has 5 modules on different topics. There's no order, and you can choose to do one, several, or all of them. Each topic has a scaled learning approach. It starts at a very basic level, introducing graphs, X and Y axes, false colored maps, and more. It builds and builds, and then in the final level, students design their own research question and use NOAA data to answer that question. If your students are already somewhat advanced, you can go quickly through the early levels. If you think your students might not be ready for an independent project, you can stop before that step. It's very flexible for what you want to do with your students. Climate.gov has tons of maps and data available. They are very visual and very easy to look at. There is also lots of modeled data available. Climate.gov also has a really great climate data primer. If you're just getting started using climate data, this website will break it down for you and help prepare you to work with it. Another great one is the Carbon Toolkit. This is an interactive, real-time atmospheric data set. This is the data source of the Keeling curve of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere over time, and there's a great student activity related to this data. We have a fairly new curriculum on oysters in the Chesapeake Bay. There are lessons available for all grades from K through 12, and the middle and high school modules use historic data. Even if you're not in the immediate Chesapeake Bay region, the information that's available here translates really nicely to other regions. This can be used to learn about ecosystems or bivalves anywhere. Our sea level rise viewer is a really cool one. It takes elevation information from coastal areas and shows you what that area would look like under a set amount of sea level rise from 1 to 10 feet. It shows you specifically what would be underwater. This does not offer any predictions of what could happen, but it's just an interesting way to see how sea level rise may impact your community. There are also scenarios and specific features that you can look at in individual regions. The National Data Buoy Center is a really cool, easy, and straightforward one to use. There are hundreds of buoys across the globe, including some in freshwater. All you need to do is go to this website, click on a buoy, and then you will be taken to that buoy's data page. There is a lot that can be done with the data collected from the buoys. One thing that you can do is pick a buoy and look at that data every day. You can start to build a graph of that area's data over time, so it's a great way to introduce graphs. Another thing that's really interesting to see is water temperature as a hurricane passes over. If there's a hurricane or tropical storm forming, and you think one of these buoys is going to be in its path, it can be really cool to see how the water temperature drops dramatically as the hurricane passes over that buoy. The Science on a Sphere Explorer mobile app is a fairly new offering. It's available on Android and Apple devices, and it's a free download. If you've ever been to a museum or another type of institution that has one of our Science on a Spheres, then you've seen the 6-foot globe suspended from the ceiling with global and planetary data that's projected on it. In the app, you can bring this experience into the palm of your hand, which is really cool, and there are actually some things available on the app that you can't experience with the sphere itself. For example, you can see the locations of satellites around the Earth. You can't see those on the actual Science on a Sphere because they would be off the sphere. So this is a great extra bonus that's available on the app. The National Snow and Ice Data Center shows off a lot of cool, pun intended, cryosphere data sets. There's a lot in this website to dig through. So I'm going to tell you one of my favorite ones that's a little hard to find. That one is Repeat Glacier Photography. This website pulls historic photos of glaciers and pairs them with recent photos, so you can see how glaciers have gotten smaller over time. This can be very dramatic and meaningful for students to understand what's happening on our planet. The Coral Reef Information System, or CORIS, has a huge amount of coral data available. This one is also a bit of a deep dive. The website has lots of publications in addition to data about corals. Unfortunately, when you search, both data and publications are pulled up in the same search, so you'll have to dig through a little bit to get to the actual data, but there's a lot available there and it's really interesting. The National Weather Service. Maybe you already get your daily weather forecast from weather.gov. There's actually a lot more available than just temperature and precipitation. The National Weather Service has information about rivers and lakes, fire weather, coastal and marine weather, and even space weather. There's a lot available, and I encourage you to dig into the types of data that they have. Jetstream is an online school for weather that doesn't have data within the website, but it's a great way for you to learn about meteorological data. If you're interested in teaching about weather, but you don't know really what meteorological data means, I definitely recommend Jetstream as a way to become more comfortable with it. If you see the topics along the side, I recommend reading through the upper air charts, and synoptic meteorology sections if you're interested in learning more about how to interpret meteorological data. NOAA also has river forecasts. Some people don't realize that NOAA actually does some freshwater monitoring as well. This website will show you flood stages and river flow at different places across the country. Like with the Buoy website, when you click on a particular dot, it will take you to that particular stream gauge's information. NOAAView is a data exploration tool, and it's a way to visualize global data. There's a tutorial available to get you started. And this is a pretty straightforward interactive map where you can add different sources of data. It's a way to visualize data similar to what Science on a Sphere does, but this one is flat instead of spherical. The National Centers for Environmental Information, or NCEI, is the world's largest climate data archive. This one is a deep, deep dive. There is a lot available here, but if you're looking for some type of weather or climate data and you can't find it anywhere else, it's probably in here. But it is quite a bit to sift through. If you're having any trouble, they have a contact page up at the top, so I do recommend reaching out to them for help. Climate Data Online is part of NCEI, part of that deep dive website. It's a great one if you're looking for historical weather data from your area. Paleoclimatology data is another one that I really like. Anytime that you talk about paleo, kids can get excited because they think you might be talking about dinosaurs. While this data isn't specifically about dinosaurs or most other extinct species, some of the data is about what was happening on our planet at that time. We can get paleoclimatology data from things like ice cores and coral records and more. The Integrated Ocean Observing System, or IOOS, is another big deep dive. They have a lot of regional specific data, and you can select whatever region you're interested in and explore the data from there. Finally, I wanted to talk a bit about citizen science and how you and your students can become collectors of data. Citizen science is also known as community science or community-based science. In the federal government, we tend to use the term citizen science, but if you are more comfortable with community science or community-based science, please feel free to use those words instead. In citizen science, your students can participate in the scientific process and address real-world problems while working with scientific data that people are studying right now. There are a few different types of things that you and your students may be able to do. The most likely and straightforward one is to collect and analyze data, which can lead to making new discoveries, but definitely get started with collecting and analyzing data. There are a lot of different projects available, many of which can be done from your home, your backyard, or just outside wherever you live. Some use a mobile device or some simple equipment. There are definitely things that you can do at any time from any location. You can find all federal citizen science projects at citizenscience.gov. SciStarter is another great resource to look for more projects, and I recommend checking out both of these. Here are a few projects that I think are really cool and you could get started on soon if you're interested. The first one is KOROC. KOROC is the Community Collaborative Rain, Hail, and Snow Network. It is a precipitation collection program that helps improve the resolution of precipitation events. Many of us have experienced a rainstorm where it's pouring if you look out one window and dry and sunny if you look out another. Precipitation events can be really patchy, so this project helps us learn more about what is happening during storms. For this project, you are asked to purchase a specific low-cost rain gauge so that all data collection is done by the same equipment. This is a good way to talk about using uniform instruments. Then you are asked to complete some online training before you get started. The data that's submitted is used by the National Weather Service, so it can be really meaningful for your students to know what's happening with their data. The data is also sometimes used by local government officials and emergency managers, and it's been used to determine where to send out snow plows in some communities. Even if you don't collect data with KOROC, you can still explore the data that's available. So you can look into the local stations near your school, house, or your friend's house. The GLOBE program is an international citizen science program. They often have lots and lots of projects happening at any given time, so there should be something that's interesting and available for you with whatever resources you have. Many projects involve meteorology, so there is cloud cover data, temperature data, precipitation data, and more. There are also many other kinds of projects. There is some online training for you to become a GLOBE certified teacher, and then you can get started collecting data. And again, even if you don't want to or aren't able to collect data yourself, you can explore other students' data. Being able to visualize this data is a great way for your students to connect with other people around the world are doing. So those are the resources I wanted to share with you today. I hope you learned something new and that you're excited to work more data into your day. As I said before, you can find all links at noaa.gov/data-ed-presentation-2020. If you have any questions, please feel free to email me at education@noaa.gov. Also, please follow NOAA Education on social media. We're at NOAA Education on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. I hope you have a wonderful day.